on This Week in Enterprise Tech, Privacy, Security, and ITUS Networks. Twyatt on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 131, recorded March 13th, 2015. Privacy and security. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by RingCentral, the business phone system that's in the cloud. RingCentral now integrates with Google for Work. Try RingCentral with a 30-day risk-free trial. Visit ringcentral.com or call 800-543-9980 and use the promo code TWIT. And by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 50-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. Welcome to Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But of course, I'm joined by my very special co-host, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, how are things in paradise?
I'm kind of sleepy. I had a 6 a.m. con call.
Well, it's probably because you've got those minions behind you.
Yeah. To take over the world, you need an army of minions.
Well, we're going to ask Chiebert if he could inject himself with either caffeine or meth, and we're going to go to the other side of the country to Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, hopefully you've got some of that caffeine that Chiebert seems to be lacking at the moment.
Caffeine? Me? No, never heard of it.
Fantastic.
We'll do what we can.
Well, as a fully stimulated episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech, let's get straight into the blips. The first one is kind of a doozy. It's about whether or not Amazon AWS is worth $50 billion. Now, how much is cloud computing really worth? Well, if you're Amazon, it could be that $50 billion. With Amazon just a few weeks away from releasing quarter one results with Amazon Web Services broken out as a separate item, financial companies are rushing to provide their analysis of Amazon Cloud. R.W. Baird did a thorough analysis of AWS's known partners and customers and came up with a $40 to $50 billion valuation with a $20 billion run rate by 2020. If true, that would mean that just the cloud division of Amazon is worth just shy of the total value of EMC.
Well, those financials are important because 7 in 10 businesses struggle with PCI compliance. According to a new survey by Verizon on the state of PCI compliance among organizations that handle debit and credit cards, more companies than ever are achieving some form of compliance. The data shows that between 2013 and 2014, compliance rates went up substantially for 11 out of the 12 major PCI requirements among companies required to meet the standard. These are basically companies that handle credit and debit card information. The only area where compliance rates fell during the same period pertained to security testing. About 20% of the companies reviewed were fully compliant with all PCI requirements at interim assessment, compared to just over 11% in 2013 and barely 7.5% in 2012. Now, despite that improvement, 7 out of 10 companies that achieve PCI compliance fail to maintain that status for as long as a year. What's the problem? According to the report, it's a serious lack of planning for maintenance and continuous improvement. Getting to the top is obviously easier to stay than staying there when PCI is involved.
If you have any doubts about the impact of internet video, well, Twitter just bought Periscope, a live streaming company. Apparently, more and more Twitter users have been using the Meerkat mobile app for sharing live video. We were talking that during the startup. Twitter seems to have noticed and announced the purchase of Periscope in a move to apparently complement services like Vine. So look for a lot more live video from your friends to go along with those 140-character tweets.
Do you run a Synology NAS? Well, if you do, rejoice, because you're getting upgraded for free. This past Wednesday, Synology released the beta of Disk Station Manager 5.2 across the range of their popular personal SOHO and SMB network-attached storage offerings. The update seems to be focused on expanding the benefits of the hybrid cloud to SMB and smaller. The biggest change is the integration of Docker, which allows users to containerize their apps to run on the array, in a cloud, or in a combination of the two. They've also sped up cloud syncing, added strong encryption for S3 and web dev storage, end-to-end encryption for Windows 8 and Windows 2012 server, and the rotation of iSCSI LUNs. All of this OS goodness makes your Synology array a hybrid monster.
Well, you know that Apple Watch we've all been hearing about? It's ready for the enterprise. Just when you thought it was safe to be all smug about the Apple Watch being nothing but a consumer toy, Salesforce.com has announced one of the first enterprise apps for the new device. What kind of information can people get on their wrist? Well, essential metrics on customers, notification of simple decisions for managers, and basic customer information can all show up in simplified form on a device that can be glanced at without the etiquette issues that come from pulling out a smartphone in the middle of a customer conversation. Does this mean that the Apple Watch is now an enterprise must? No, but it does mean that enterprise software vendors will see the opportunity in a new screen, and we will see enterprise apps showing up on business-oriented wrists starting in late April.
Talk about a prize at the bottom of the box. Western Digital is now offering drives that come bundled with Adobe software. CNET's story talk about Western Digital offering a sweet bundle of a 2-terabyte drive and Lightroom 5 or Photoshop and Premiere Elements 12. Just in time for Photoshop's 25th birthday, the report goes on to mention, as an example, that for $109 shipped, you can get a Western Digital Ultra 2-terabyte bundle with Adobe Photoshop Elements 12 and Premiere Elements. All apps that would need more storage, but now you can get the software and the drive in an inexpensive bundle.
Now, Superfish... forever. A month after Lenovo announced that they would stop pre-installing Superfish, reports are still coming in that new Lenovo notebooks, with the encryption-busting adware still attached, are in the channel. While this is to be expected, since supply chains being what they are, long and treacherous, the continuing bad press for Lenovo can't be good for the company. The Superfish removal tool is buggy, the instructions don't always work, and now they're getting Osborne'd by a supply chain full of, quote-unquote, defective product. Well, that's it for the blips. We're going to get straight to the bites, where we're going to be jumping into some security and privacy issues, as we are wont to do here on This Week in Enterprise Tech. But before we do that, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the first sponsor of this episode. And of course, it's got to be RingCentral. Now, there are people who call RingCentral, well, it's a phone system. And yes, that's true. But calling RingCentral a phone system is like calling the internet a series of tubes. It's kind of right, but not quite. RingCentral brings all of your communication tools together in one spot. Voice, fax, text, conference calling, high-def video meetings, pretty much everything. It's an effective way to communicate, and RingCentral can do it for you. Now, we love doing things in the cloud here at Twit, and we love RingCentral. RingCentral does all the things that I want out of my communications package. It integrates with both iOS and Android devices so that your teams can stay connected from anywhere, no matter what device they're using. RingCentral lets you keep your existing numbers, use toll-free numbers, local extensions, and even vanity numbers. And you can customize your system from a web browser or their mobile app so it works the way that you want it to work instead of you working the way your phone system works. And if you're worried about privacy, well, don't. Because your calls are encrypted and private with secure voice. Customer support is free 24/7, and there are no setup fees or activation fees. And now, RingCentral just announced RingCentral for Google, so you can integrate your company's Google for Work accounts with RingCentral into one seamless communications hub. With RingCentral for Google, your staff can use the dial pad on your screen to make calls from your Gmail account. They can click on any number on the screen in Gmail, contacts, or calendar to place a call, just like you would on your smartphone. And you can listen to voicemails directly within Gmail. Plus, you get faxing from Google Drive, viewing text messages, scheduling conference calls, and so much more. Now, here's what we want you to do. We want you to try RingCentral, to put your system in the cloud. RingCentral starts at under $25 a month per user, and you can start right now with a 30-day risk-free trial. Plus, here's a special offer for my listeners. For every desk phone you buy, you get a second phone free. Up to 20 phones. Visit ringcentral.com or call 800-543-9980 and use the promo code TWIT. Ring Central, get connected now. And we thank Ring Central for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Let's go ahead and jump into the Enterprise Bite. This first one, this is a question that should be getting asked more and more around the water cooler, and that is, who owns the results of a security investigation? Now, in an era of breaches, there have been strides, definitely positive strides, towards disclosing a zero transparent failure policy. But in a recent paper titled Confusion About Investigative Program Ownership and Responsibility, the SEC said, after working with many organizations, that the problem it has found with many of these investigations include untrained people conducting them, multiple reporting systems, confusion over who's in charge, and no real corporate oversight. Now, this is to be expected. Anytime you have a mad dash to fix a problem, there's going to be confusion. But the question is whether or not the enterprise world can rally and maybe turn this into a positive. I want to turn this over to Cheebert. Cheebert, of the three of us, you are the one who has had the most experience with forensic security accounting, looking back to see what has happened. I don't want to talk too much about it because I know you have some NDA stuff in here, but what would you say is your take on this report? Are they dead right? When they say that enterprises are making strides towards disclosing breaches, but they don't really know how to set them up yet, would you agree?
I would totally agree. If you're dealing with the Department of Defense, you know, there's some nice standardization on how things happen. So at large organizations, there's usually some sort of security officer. In the DoD, it's called an Information System Security Manager, or ISSM. But even in those cases, many of the breaches start off with finger pointing. Who's responsible? Who's taking over? And the big issue is a lot of these organizations have not given the security officer enough authority to be able to go and say, hey, work together, you do this, you do that, and so forth. So this finger pointing is a lot on who's responsible for what. So one of the things that some larger organizations have done is they've added to the C-suite, so a chief security officer. But the problem is, have they really given them enough authority? You know, it's like if you have law enforcement, you know, the cops go and take over an investigation. It's pretty clear cut. If it crosses state lines, well, maybe the FBI, but the rules are pretty cut and dry. In the case of a breach, not so much. So my suggestion really is, you know, follow the money. Who owns the department or the, you know, the data that was touched by the breach? They should probably be the person directly coordinating with the CSO or whoever the security manager is, and so forth. But here's some of the issues. The FBI has traditionally determined who has jurisdiction by how much the breach costed the organization. Part of the reporting process is to quantify what the perceived loss was and what the provable loss was. They're a little different. And here's the other problem. A lot of the local police departments won't even investigate if the physical loss was under $2,500 for physical property or $10,000 for the perceived loss of revenue. I'm kind of hoping Devin Mudd is in the chat room so he can chime in. He's works for a PD and might be able to tell us more. So here's something I'd like to show, you know, talk about for the future. In the 2014 Black Hat keynote, Dan Geer suggested that we should have a zero tolerance for reporting, complete transparency, but that there should be a government or independent organization that has oversight for breaches. The finger pointing really and truly just has to stop. And the last thing I want to say is, you know, I'm talking to a lot of forensics companies. Very, very few organizations keep good enough records or recordings of the internet traffic or logs to even get a decent investigation going. So in talking to some of the folks at NetScout, they actually had a breach. You know, they worked with a company, but that company had actually recorded everything. Pretty cool, because then the FBI, when they investigated, had literally everything they wanted to do. So what I want to do is, you know, what have you seen? So Kurt, What have you seen in the corporate suites? You know, are these trends going further, or are people actually backing away?
Well, here's my take, and mine also comes, interestingly enough, from the last Black Hat conference, where I was talking to a bunch of people, and the general consensus is that more and more you're seeing outside law firms, the external legal counsel, taking ownership for investigations and even for the forensics done as part of compliance reviews. Why is that? Because the client and lawyer privilege applies to communications between the company and their external counsel. That privilege doesn't apply to communications between a company and its internal counsel. That means that the external counsel can have the forensics done and can report on the results. But if regulators or if the government goes after the company, then the details that are released at the discretion of the company because they're covered under that privileged communication. So it's really something that's the opposite of transparency. While a lot of people talk about the wonders of transparency, what they really want to do is control that transparency, because they know that if they control the flow of information, they can also control the basis on which they might be sued by shareholders or those who are affected by the breach. It's a lot of push-pull, a lot of different stakeholders at work, but I think that the company portion that's going to control more and more of these investigations is going to be that external counsel for the reasons we just talked about.
You know, one of the things that I'm seeing here is we've got people in the chat room who are saying, well, if you paid for the investigation, you own the data. But as Chiebert mentioned, and as Curtis elaborated on, it's not that simple anymore. You've got law offices that are now coming, law enforcement agencies that are now coming in and saying, well, we're going to start seeing some compliance issues with you where you have to be able to disclose a breach in a certain amount of time. But even beyond that, within the structure of any major enterprise, and Chiebert, again, you mentioned this, you're going to have different divisions who are going to be saying, wait a minute, we were most affected, or we paid for the investigation, so therefore, all we owe you is a summary. We owe you what happened, but we don't necessarily have to share all the data that went into the creation of the report that shows you what happened. And that's one of the interesting points about this discussion, which is it's not just what happened, who took what, who was most affected. It's now all the reams of paper, all the digital data, all the evidence that gets collected in coming to that conclusion, and who rightfully owns that. I mean, if you look at it from a government perspective, well, the people own it. The people whose information was compromised should have access to that information. If you're looking at it from the perspective of the enterprise, then maybe the division that was most affected, or the division out of whom's budget the investigation came out of, should own that data. It's a fascinating way to look at who owns security, who owns privacy. It goes way beyond just the simple, well, you should be transparent. Chiebert, last words from you.
Follow the money. It's really and truly coming down to that. Who paid, who was affected? And when certain thresholds are crossed, sorry, but law enforcement can and sometimes does get involved.
Yeah, and I think we can end it with Specs in the chat room, who says something that I think a lot of people kind of relate to, and that is internal investigations are not to be trusted. So unless you're turning it over to a third party, either law enforcement or other, then your investigation probably stays with you. Let's go ahead and move on to the second enterprise buy. This one, I kind of grin a little bit, because here on Twite, we've talked a lot about big data. We've talked a lot about data mining. We've talked a lot about the promise of ubiquitous Internet of Things versus the privacy violations that can occur and the Kafkaesque nightmare of having your data out in the open. Well, while we were arguing about whether or not the next big enterprise and the next big cloud service was going to take the Internet of Things seriously, Disney just did it. That's right. If you took take a look at Disney's park in Orlando, they placed a $2 billion bet on Magic Band. Now, what is Magic Band? Quite simply, Magic Band is a rubber wristband that has an RFID chip and a 2.4 gigahertz radio and a battery with enough power to last for 2 years. Now, it will fill out your itinerary ahead of time if you participate in the Magic Band Magic Express, and then everything is taken care of for you. For example, if you put this thing on as you're boarding your plane from wherever you're coming from to go to the Magic Kingdom, you touch down at the Orlando airport and your luggage is automatically routed to your hotel. You board a shuttle that takes you to the park, but you don't have to pay or hunt for confirmation numbers on your phone. You get to the park, you walk straight through the gate without tickets. You don't need cash or a credit card because your Magic Band is linked to your credit card. Disney has already figured out the best way for you to enjoy your day without walking back and forth because you filled out that initial questionnaire of what rides and restaurants you were interested in. So it tells you you should do this, this, and this so you don't have to walk all over the park. Now, you walk straight up to the rides that you've reserved, you bypass the lines, you show off your little Magic Band, and you walk right aboard. And when you want to eat, like for example at the BR Guest restaurant at the center of the park, you go across the bridge. And by the time you cross the bridge, there's a server there who welcomes you by name and tells you to take any seat that you want because your food, which you pre-ordered, will just find its way to you. That's what Disney is doing with the Internet of Things. Now, we could sit back and say, that is a gross violation of every sort of privacy. You've linked a band to something that is inherently insecure. You've given all this personal information to a company that will probably mine the heck out of it. But, Chiebert, my question to you is did Disney figure this out? Did Disney figure out that we are willing to take that kind of a security risk, that kind of an Internet of Things Kafka-esque nightmare, if it means that everything just works?
Well, the Magic Kingdom, in my opinion, is all about showmanship. Mm. And if things magically happen, it's the magic of Disney. So, you know, several generations are pre-programmed to have magic happen in the Disney world. Now, you keep in mind, Disney's already been doing some things. So you see in this video, they're actually scanning your fingerprint. Disney has been scanning your fingerprint for a heck of a long time. Mm-hmm. They're just stepping it up and making more of the details invisible. I actually sent this off, this link off to you and Curtis, but Curtis and I are thinking, wow, if I manage to make it to Infocom in June, I'm going to get myself a Magic Band and give it a try because, you know, I really don't want to have to fuss around with a lot of long lines. In fact, one of the things the story goes on to say is they have the ability that if you're sitting in line for too long, Disney will start automatically, magically making discount coupons or free rides or stuff magically appear. And isn't this what a lot of consumers really and truly want? They want the technology to work for them. They want the technology to be customized for them. And if Disney follows their previous policies, Disney so far doesn't seem to have really abused the data they've been gathering on you. I've been to Disney World and Disneyland many, many times, and I actually don't even get spammed by them as a result of those trips. I get spammed by them because I've signed up for other Disney things. So I think they're doing it right.
Curtis, I want to throw this over to you because 8-Bit Steve in the chat room actually makes a good point. He says, I don't like the term IoT, Internet of Things. It's a wristband that knows who you are. How is this any different than any other NFC device connected to a database? And actually, this is a good question because when we start talking about Internet of Things, in the first wave, it was just devices that are hooked up to the internet. But you noticed this trend at CES. Internet of Things has now come to mean a better way to gather data points. Data points are what we really want. Data points, that is the Internet of Things. That's the only reason why we would make the Internet of Things. And in this case, you become the ultimate Internet of Things. If they have your information, if they know where you're going, how long you've been waiting, what you're buying, what you're eating, how much you're spending, you are the best data point they could ever have in an Internet of Things, right?
Oh, without question. And they do that. They mine the dickens out of this. There are some large data centers just south of the kingdom in Celebration where they do all of this. The cool thing about it is that, you know, as you point out, you are encouraged before your visit to go ahead and tell them which rides you want to do, especially the high-demand rides, things like Soarin' in Epcot and the various it's been a while since I've had a small child, but the Magic Kingdom rides that tend to have long lines.
You're thinking of It's a Small World, Curtis.
Stuff of my nightmares, yes. But what they will do is look at... thank you so much. What they'll do is look at where you go when you're not doing those rides that you've pre-selected. What are you doing to fill out your visit? And they will incorporate that into statistical averages about what people who choose particular rides want to do in the rest of their time. Disney has an interesting problem in that they are very close on many days to suffering from their success. They know that people will put up with a slight delay, a short line, but not a long line, especially not a long line everywhere they go. And so they're doing massive time in motion optimization with these. And, you know, they can do all sorts of cool things. For example, if you're there in a party with children, they get their magic bands, and you can place limits on how much they can charge on those bands. You can place limits on whether those bands will work to lock and unlock doors, or and whether or not an adult has to be with them to do certain things. Lots of gradations on what can be done using the bands. Plus, there are games that can be played, all kinds of things. And yes, they had some very notable rough spots during the rollout. But over the course of the past couple of years, they've gotten them smoothed out. And now people love the magic bands as part of the experience. As a matter of fact, you can get your own custom magic bands. It's not just a way to get in and out. It's a souvenir and some of the jewelry that you can wear and bring back again and again, because you simply reload it with new information every time you want to come back to the Magic Kingdom.
I have to say that our very own Brian Burnett, Cranky Hippo, he's my TD, my co-host on Know How, he went to the Magic Kingdom recently and he used the Magic Band system and he loved it. He absolutely loved it. Jason Howell did the same thing. He used the Magic Band and he loved it. So I think this is an interesting intersection of worlds where we know that people will take a little bit of invasion into their privacy in order for things that work. That's the whole social media phenomenon. Facebook, Google Plus, Twitter, they all do that. You give us a peek into your lives and we'll give you a service that you like. I think Disney just took that to the next level, which is it's now in real life. It's now something that's on you. It's now something that gives you real world tangible benefits. So Cheevert, I want to throw this over to you. Is it just us? Is it us enterprise wonks, us pundits who are looking at this and saying, this doesn't sound like a good system at all? I mean, I understand why you want it, but do you understand how much data you're putting out there?
You know, I'm sorry. You know, there's an awful lot of corporations mining an awful lot of data. I don't think we're ever going to be able to escape that. I'm of the opinion that, this is kind of a white hat thing. Disney's done something very good with large-scale data sets, you know, the big data, and they've done good things with it. You know, I'm of the opinion is you can do good things with big data, you can do bad things with big data. I think we should pat Disney on the back and say, attaboy.
I will say this, though. It does worry me. That's why when I'm in Orlando next week for the Enterprise Connect conference, I will not be going to Disney World. Instead, I will be going to the Wizarding World of Harry Potter. Now, when we come back, we are welcoming back to the show a guest we've had a few times. He was with Sonic Wall when we first had him on This Week in Enterprise Tech. Then he started his own company that was founded on the idea of giving enterprise-class security to the masses. That's right. We've got Daniel Ayoub from ITUS Networks. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank the second sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. And that's got to be ZipRecruiter. Now, are you hiring? Do you need to find the right person with the right talents fast? Now, these days, hiring is more about than just finding a person with the right skills or training. You got to have someone who's a qualified candidate who could fit into the culture of your business. I've done my share of hiring, and the process was always the same. You post a job listing, you get candidates, you have screen candidates, you hire the best candidate, and about 50% of the time, you regret it because it wasn't the right fit. The problem is that you need to cast as wide a net as possible to ensure that you are getting the best candidates. And you need to put your posting in a place where you'll find those candidates who are right for that position and your culture. That's why we use ZipRecruiter. Now, ZipRecruiter understands that posting your job in one place isn't enough to find all those quality candidates that we talked about. If you want to find the perfect hire, you need to post your job on all the top job sites. And that's what ZipRecruiter does for you. With ZipRecruiter.com, you post your job once and it gets placed on 50-plus job sites, including Craigslist, LinkedIn, and Twitter, all with a single click. ZipRecruiter will help you find candidates in any city or industry nationwide. Just post once and watch your qualified candidates roll in to ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. And now ZipRecruiter offers Traffic Boost, which can get you up to 3 times as many qualified candidates for your job opening. There will be no juggling emails or calls to your office. Instead, you scan, you rate, and you hire the right person fast. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 200,000 businesses. Right now, our listeners can try ZipRecruiter for free, plus get 30% off your first Traffic Boost by going to ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. Let's go ahead and give a hearty Twyatt Riot welcome to a man who I think has sort of become our own personal guru of all things home security, SMB security, Mr. Daniel Ayoub. Daniel, thank you very much for coming back on to Twyatt.
Hi, Padre. Thank you so much for having me. Great to be here.
Now, the last time you were on, we had you briefly giving us an update about the ITUS Network's iGuardian. And the idea was to take the same processors that are used in some of SonicWall's high-end security appliances, not with quite as many cores, and use that to do some real-time filtering of information flowing into and, more importantly, out of your network. Now, the first time we had you on the show was before the whole Sony breach, so I think it became more poignant. And now the question is, do you have any updates on whether or not those who have pre-ordered on Kickstarter will be able to get their Guardians?
Yeah, so we expect to begin shipping next month in April. So we expect everybody will get their units at that time. And we're very excited. I've got the external beta running right now. And I brought a couple of the beta units with me to kind of show you a little bit about them today.
Yeah, Zach, go ahead and can you switch the overhead? Because I've been waiting to see these things for a while. And, we'll get those into the frame. This is what they're going to look like, right? These are the ones that are actually coming off of the assembly lines?
Yep. So these are the production units that we'll have. And these are, again, the ones that we're using for beta. You can see a little bit of modification to the enclosure since last time you guys saw them. Basically just some holes being drilled in. Some of the silk screening will change and things like that. But yeah, that's basically the form factor. Small enough to fit in the palm of your hand, but power enough to be put into a rack someplace.
Oh, fantastic. Now, I think this is an interesting opportunity for us to actually ask you about what it takes to do a startup in this space. Because this is a crowded area. There are a lot of big players with a lot of money, and it's not easy to get in. I've seen a lot of startups fail because they just can't muscle their way in past a Netgear or a Cisco or a Linksys or a Belkin or anyone else who's playing in that SOHO small to medium business space. What did you have to do to make this happen? Because I know it's been a long journey.
It's been a long journey. It's been about a year since I started the project, the idea of starting ITUS. And hardware is a tough game. I mean, just like you said, there's a lot of big players in the industry. It costs a lot of, it's very capital intensive to get the products designed, to get them manufactured. I mean, there's just all sorts of barriers everywhere. But I think persistence and determination and hard work and having the right team and idea really kind of helps a lot.
All right. There are going to be some people, and I see them in the chat room right now, who need a refresher course on what the Guardian does. Because I understand what you're going for. Basically, it's a firewall, but it's a firewall that's different than any firewall that you may have ever purchased for your home or your small business. In that, it also takes a look at outgoing traffic. So if you were ever worried about something like a Sony breach thing happening to you, this is a firewall that will actually start to question why you have such large amounts of data going out on non-standard ports. Tell me how the iGuardian works.
Yeah, so the product itself is much more than just a traditional firewall. When you talk about firewall, you're usually thinking things like stateful packet inspection and just the ability to open and block ports. This box actually can do a lot more than that. We can do antivirus right at the gateway level, right at the network level, so that as files are being downloaded, they're being scanned on the box. before they're being released to your browser. So you have a level of antivirus integrated right into the box. You've also got, as you mentioned, the ability to do inline intrusion prevention. So if there are devices on your network that are exposed to the public internet, maybe via a DMZ or some port forwarding or something like that, or you have a baby monitor that you access remotely or whatever it may be, these products typically have a lot of vulnerabilities in them and are often found to have a lot of opportunity for attackers to kind of get in. I mean, we've all heard the stories. But basically, the appliance is able to inspect the traffic coming in and going out of the network in real time, look for things like malicious attacks, exploits, malware, even bad websites that you might not want little kids going to. And it's got all of those services kind of layered into a really small, efficient, and kind of plug-and-play form factor. The cool thing about this also is typically when you look at these kind of a product that's going to provide you things like antivirus, intrusion prevention, firewalling, content filtering, usually when you buy those boxes, they're quite expensive if they're going to have any decent type of performance to them, usually in the order of magnitude of about $1,000 or higher. And they usually require a very expensive annual subscription to continue getting the data feeds to update all those signatures. We actually, not only did we make the hardware very affordable, but we provide a lifetime free update service for all of our customers so that you get the latest essential security updates on a regular basis. It's all turnkey, plug and play, no manual intervention needed. So it's kind of designed for, you know, any kind of user, but the cool thing is there's a lot of really high-tech stuff going on under the surface. So anybody that's interested in kind of diving in, getting their hands dirty and playing with the technology, there's a lot there for you to be able to do.
Now, Daniel, I got to say, on behalf of the chat room, who they're clamoring to get a look at this, I got to say, look, talk is cheap. I mean, I've heard these talking points before. Pretty much any time I go to a conference, there's going to be some vendor who is trying to tell me that this is a turnkey solution. It's plug and play. We just go and I'm not doubting that. But what we're going to ask of you, and I'm going to let you set up here for a bit, is we actually want you to demo this product. We've seen it in small chunks here and there. I'm hoping that you've brought your game, because yeah, we want to see this product actually in action. Before we do that, Chiebert, I know you've been following ITUS Networks for a while. And you know, one of the things that's coming up in the chat room, they're saying, look, even some high-end home-built firewalls like pfSense don't necessarily do a good scanning of outbound traffic. And that strikes at one of the strengths of a product like this, which is they're using a processor that is specifically designed to do deep packet inspection. And that's not easy to do, right? You can't just throw a general purpose CPU or GPU at it and say go.
Oh, sure you can. If you want to go and put a dual quad core Xeon machine running Linux and customize the heck out of all your scripts. Yeah, sure. And oh, by the way, that I know for a fact in Hawaii, that dual quad core Xeon machine is going to cost you an extra $25 a month in electricity.
Right. So this is one of those applications where you've got a specific set of processors that are energy saving, they're basically DSPs, I believe, that look at each and every single packet, both incoming and outgoing, and look for suspicious activity as defined by a vulnerability database. Daniel, what are some of the demos that we're going to see today?
Sure. So I've got, I can do the content filtering. I've got the IPS running. I can show you some DNS blacklisting type stuff. And yeah, we can kind of go through there. I'll show you the user interface, kind of how to turn it on, how to use it, that kind of thing.
Take us through it, sir.
All right. Very good. So the first thing you'll see here is I've got a console attached to the appliance. So when you log in, I'm using a terminal emulator, and it's just a Linux command prompt. So I'm just going to show you the kind of processes that are running in the background, just so you can kind of get an idea of what's actually happening here under the surface. The first thing you'll notice is you've got Snort kind of going through there. That's the inline intrusion prevention. That's going to be able to look at all the traffic coming in and going out of the network to look for exploits, malware callbacks, bad DNS lookups to known Trojan servers, things like that. Also, you've got Clam, which is the antivirus engine, and then E2 Guardian is the content filter. And you can see each of these are kind of running in here. I'll just open up the web management system here. And kind of cool thing is you don't have to look up for an IP address. You can just type in shield.lan, and it'll take you there. And we can log into the appliance. And you can see here's kind of the the user interface to it. So there's a lot of really nice bells and whistles in here, but I'm going to kind of start out by just showing a little bit of kind of the graphical stuff. So if you want to see what kind of stress the box is under, how much is, you know, how taxing it is to the CPU, you've got some nice little visualization graphs in here. You've also got some bandwidth management, so you can kind of see how much traffic is coming in. You can even look at the active connections on the box. So some really nice kind of eye candy in here, and it'll update itself like in real time. So kind of cool. Some of the stuff that we've incorporated in terms of like the security would be things like the intrusion prevention engine. And you'll notice there when I click it, it actually is restarting the engine in real time in the background. So you can see it kind of just restarted the engine there so that it can repopulate with all the new settings available to you. So this is the configuration menu for it. And it's very easy. You can, again, one click on or off for the IPS. You have the ability to specify which interface you want it running over. And then we have some pre-tuned profiles, which basically are going to tell the IPS how much memory to allocate to different places. So if you come under these advanced settings, this is the actual configuration file for the intrusion prevention system. And again, this is probably way deeper than what a lot of folks are looking for. But if you are that technical advanced user and you want to get your hands dirty and you want to be able to play with it, this is a lot of flexibility right here that you're normally not going to have. The other thing is, this is typically all done through the CLI. So having the ability to do it through the web GUI is interesting. So you asked about the rule databases that are running on here and some of the tests that we'll be looking at. So these are the actual rules that I've got installed on the box right now. Okay, and you can see they start out with the word reject. That's telling it to drop the session. And then it kind of gives you a little bit of a description of what it's actually looking for. So what I'm going to do is you can see the rules, and then you can come over here, and this is the log of all the things that the IPS is seeing right now. Okay, so I'm plugged into your network, and it's seeing some SNMP stuff and not really liking it, but that's another thing.
That would be cranky hippo.
Yeah. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to grab one of these blacklist DNS malware URLs out of here.
Daniel, you know, while you go at this, it strikes me that one of the conversations we had the first time you showed this off was you wanted this to be as plug and play simple that you could give it to your grandmother.
Right.
But you also wanted experts. You wanted people who like to tinker to be able to get in there. And these are all standard modules, right? I mean, these are just these are what you've got packet snort or I can't remember what packages you included in this.
Yeah. So that's exactly right. It is completely plug and play in the sense that you can just power on the box and you can run it either as a bridge, as a router, or in gateway mode. One of the things you'll see here on the front of the box is this little switch. So to make it very easy so that when you just, you don't even have to go into the web UI, there are pre-tuned profiles that are already installed on the box. So if I put it into B and I plug it in, it's going to boot the box as a bridge, and it's going to have Snort already running in line as an intrusion prevention, not just detection, but actually prevention, across these two interfaces right here. So you can run it as a transparent bridge. It's a bump in the wire. It's invisible. The next mode over here is router mode, and that's the middle setting. And that's what I've got kind of showing on the demo right here. Basically, what that's going to do is that's going to boot it, and you have a LAN, a WAN, and a DMZ. So you got your three interfaces. And that's kind of what it's showing right now. So when it boots up in router mode, you're going to have the intrusion prevention system, you're going to have the content filter, and you're going to have the antivirus all starting at the same time, in addition to the firewall and everything else. And that's kind of what we have here. So I'm kind of diving really deep into the more technical side of it.
Get back into it. Go.
Yeah, but it's definitely not something that is required. So if you just want to be able to take it and plug and play, you can see that it does that. So okay, I got a error back when I tried to do a lookup on that domain, and then let's kind of come in here. I might have to refresh the screen here, but we now should see that entry in the log. And again, it's going to take a second here for the snort. Every time you click out of the web UI, it restarts it at this point. This is a beta version of the software, but that's to ensure that it will always have the correct settings that you've most recently applied. So basically, I should be able to come in here now and see that it will block that attempt to look up that data. So these are some of the things that you'll be able to do. Some of the things that's kind of nice also is you have the ability to very easily, if this is per se a false positive and we want to remediate it, I can simply take that rule, find it in the list, comment it out, and then move on so that that rule is no longer firing or alerting. And that's...
Oh, that's nice.
That's basically, you know, you can do that all right through the web UI. And this is the V1, right? So the future version will be all remediation based upon just clicking little buttons. You won't have to actually find the number and apply it. But for the early version, that's kind of where we are at. I can show you the web content filter also, another system here, doing something a little bit different.
While you're bringing that up, we've got questions coming in from the chat room. And the first is, how would you use this in your current system? So let's say you've got a current router, you've got a gateway. Where does the Guardian go in line?
So the appliance can be installed in a number of different methods. So if you have at home a inline, or you have a setup where you have a separate modem and a router as two devices, you can put the device as a bridge, and you can just plug it in between the two devices, so it'll sit on the WAN and it'll see all the traffic coming in and going out of the network. When you run it in that mode, you're going to get inline intrusion prevention. The other option is you can run it in router mode. And when you run it in router mode, what that's going to do is you basically would put your wireless access, your wireless router now as an access point. You plug it in here, and this device is going to act as your DHCP server, as your firewall, everything at that point, and you're going to be running your entire network off of this box at that point.
Right.
So there are a couple of different ways. The third deployment mode that I didn't really mention too much before is gateway mode, and that's going to be released as an experimental build in the first release. But basically what that does, if you have one of the all-in-one wireless gateways with a cable modem and wireless router built into it, or a DSL modem and a wireless router built into the single box, you can attach the Shield appliance with a single Ethernet cable to your all-in-one gateway, turn it on in that default mode, and it will basically sanction a man-in-the-middle attack on your entire network. So it's going to basically ARP spoof the entire network, reroute all the traffic on that local subnet through the Shield appliance, and then run it through the content filter, through the IPS and through the antivirus engine to kind of clean it before sending it out to the appropriate.
So there's a follow-up to that, and I know that there's people in the chat room who I know kind of have their mouth watering over this. If I could do that to, say, a network that I am administering, my grandmother's network, my parents' network, do you have some sort of VPN function for me to come in and do remote administration, or do you have plans to include that?
So the appliance right now has SSL VPN capabilities, and that's provided by OpenVPN. Again, these are features that for the first release will be included. Whether they will be officially supported for the first release, maybe not. But we will definitely have them in there for the advanced users looking for that kind of functionality. For the first release, the real core focus is on the security services,
right,
making sure that it is plug and play, that everything turns on the way it does, and that the web UI functions as expected, all those types of things.
But I could see our audience, like you said, installing this in your parents' or grandparents' house and running that man-in-the-middle attack just to make sure that nothing untoward is happening in the network. That's kind of a dream, right? You could, someone calls you with a technical question, you look back over your logs and say, oh no, you've got a Trojan on one of your computers, and this is the MAC address. Oh, by the way, yeah, it's that computer. Take that computer offline, and you'll be good.
Yep.
The other questions that we had from the chat room are, what's the throughput on it, and how many clients, nodes, will it handle?
So the number of clients or nodes shouldn't, for what you'd find in a typical household, I don't think you're going to have any problems. I think I've got up to about 50 devices so far without any issues. We're going to be running the external beta, and we'll get some real stress done to the boxes at that time, so we'll know. In terms of throughput for the initial release for intrusion prevention, for inline IPS, we're targeting about 50 megabits per second of throughput. Now, if you're running it just as a stateful firewall, or you're running it for other security services, it'll vary. But the variance is pretty wide. So in my testing, again, when I run it just as a stateful packet inspection firewall, and I'm just doing a test where I'm downloading from the WAN to the LAN, I'm getting close to line rate, maybe 850 to 925 megabits per second at that speed. And that really has to do with, again, that Cavium CPU being able to do this. If we didn't have the type of processors, the amount of RAM, all this kind of stuff built in here, you really would not be able to get those levels of throughput that you'd find. And even a lot of the quite expensive, like SMB, kind of lower end UTM appliances out there don't provide you with that level of performance.
So. Yeah, Cheebert's actually tested this, where a lot of those lower end boxes that claim certain throughput, when you push it, when you push that much data, they actually stop doing deep packet inspection. They'll back off because that's the only way they're going to be able to route the packets quick enough. A couple more questions, and you know, continue with your demo, but PCGuy8088 wants to know how much is logged and where it's logged. So if you actually wanted to log the traffic going through a network, how would that work? And MyTallest42 wants to know about notifications. So, for example, once you have this thing set up the way you want it, how do you get notified that a DDoS attack is running on your network, or that there seems to be a computer in your network that is sending out way too much information on a port that shouldn't be used?
Yeah, so and again, in the initial release, a lot of that is going to be focused primarily on the logging that's built into the system. And we've got that kind of set up so that you can see these right through the web UI. A lot of this stuff is traditionally done all through the CLI, through the console. So we've actually created a custom web UI to be able to interface with a lot of these third-party tools or you know, open source tools that we've kind of integrated for the security services. So I'll kind of show you a little bit of that if you guys want to see kind of the logging. So the web filter might be a good one. And again, you can run this thing in basic or in advanced mode. You see right now it's running in basic mode. So I only have a basic settings and a logs field. But we can see basically any website that is visited, any transaction that's going through, it's all captured in here. Now, in first future versions of the appliance, one of the things on the roadmap for a new release coming you know, shortly after we ship will be support for a mobile app for your mobile phone, so that you have the ability to sync it with an Android or an iOS phone, and you can actually receive alerts and notifications, push notifications to the device. Whether that'll be included with the free subscription or part of the premium subscription, maybe, maybe not. Right. But that is something that is also kind of in the works in the background on here.
One more thing. And again, yeah, this is more for our enterprise-oriented audience about logging to syslog. So, for example, let's say I'm using a tool like Splunk, and I want to collect all those logs. That should be possible, right? Because, I mean, I can pretty much configure this any way I want.
Absolutely. So again, the same kind of way I was showing you kind of these deep dives on some of the screens here for managing the actual engines of the IPS, all that, you can also configure a syslog server in your home or wherever. If you're running it as in a small business, you want to send the logs offsite. It's all doable. It's all there. And again, these are things that we're looking at integrating into future releases. For now, we've got some of this stuff. So you have the ability to, let's see here, if my full screen doesn't want to cooperate with the system here, but you have the ability to do syslog exporting right now, okay? And that's already integrated into it, and that's going to basically export this system log. Now, you could, you know, we can put together a nice little script that you can collect all the logs and send them out that way. Not terribly difficult to be able to implement something like that. But again, things that are coming for future releases. And just in case anybody is wondering about foreign language support, Padre, pick a language.
Oh, Spanish?
Spanish, all right. Spanish on the list?
Or bad English?
Second from the top, there we go. All right, I've got support for something like 10 or 12 languages in here, and it will translate in real time. Yay. So you can kind of see now we can run in Spanish. If you
really put thought into this. I mean, so I gotta imagine that all of your experience working with SonicWall, now Dell SonicWall, translated into this, because this interface looks very clean. This is very familiar to what I used to see.
You know, I think there are similarities in a lot of products. You probably will find that. And I think a lot of what we've done here is try to give people, 80% of the features at 20% of the cost, kind of a thing, and really providing a lot of it. And again, this is the V1. It's very feature rich. We've got a lot of capabilities baked in here, but there's a lot coming also, and there's a lot of things that we can do that we're kind of just starting to scratch the surface right now. And quite excited to get the product out and start shipping, and great to be able to show it to folks and show them, you know, kind of the progress that's been made. So this, as it is right now, I think is pretty good. I'd be happy to you know, have it and use it. And
seriously, our audience right now is they're loving this. They're in the chat room going, okay, so where do I give my money? It was a Kickstarter, folks. So the people who supported the Kickstarter will be getting their units. You think you're going to be shipping next month or so?
Yeah. So we again we delayed production simply to have enough time to run the beta. We ran into a little bit of an issue with getting the beta units sent out on time. So that was kind of part of it. But yeah. We're going to be starting production probably at the end of this month, the beginning of next month, and we will start shipping orders in April. But if anybody is interested, they like what they see, they want to learn more, or they're interested in ordering one, we're still taking pre-orders on our website right now at itusnetworks.com.
One last question from the chat room, at least I think it might be the last one, from PS Chops. He's been asking this a few times, which is why I bring it up. He wants to know how firmware would be updated.
Yeah.
And again, I'm sure he's thinking, well, if I install this remotely, will I be able to VPN in, tunnel in, and update the firmware on the box?
Yeah, so part of what we're trying to incorporate for the first release is the ability to have automatic updates for the firmware. And that'll be something that we will have at some point, whether it will be shipped with it, probably, most likely. But if not, you'll have the first rev may require to do manual updates of the firmware. But yeah, the long-term vision is to have an automatic updating mechanism for the firmware. Padre, can I show one thing?
We have? Yes, you can.
Okay.
Go.
So we talked a lot about those Cavium processors, and I just want to give you guys kind of an idea or a peek of what this is actually able to do. So this is testing OpenSSL, just crunching numbers, basically, right? And I'm testing AES 128-bit CBC, blockchaining, and it's crunching these numbers. And right now, I've compiled this image using the Cavium toolchain, and I told it to run this over the two cores. So we can see it gave me a score down here. And what I'm going to do is, just for comparison purposes, I'm going to paste the scores so you can kind of see them side by side. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to run the exact same test, but this time I'm going to use that acceleration module that Cavium has incorporated into this Octeon chip. And you'll see just how big of a performance difference it makes when it's offloading the CPU and actually running the test using that offloading engine. It's kind of like having a little ASIC on the side to be able to do really high, powerful... very, very powerful okay. kind of inspection.
Could all you right. copy that and paste that so we can
yeah.
enlarge it?
Because so
wow.
All right. So again, and this is
folks. Custom silicon is a good thing.
Yeah. So I think this is like the largest key size. I think this is like 1024 something like this. But you can see there's 20x improvement, 15x improvement.
A couple of orders of magnitude there. That's nice.
So yeah, there is something to be said about using a high-end enterprise class CPU in this kind of a product. If you think about implementing something like Man in the Middle for SSL inspection, which again is something that we're looking at, not maybe for the first release, but for future ones, having this kind of capability, having this kind of a chip in here opens up the options for us to be able to do that. Some of the competitor products I've seen coming onto the market are woefully underpowered, and if you look at the specs, it's amazing that they're charging what they are for it. It's almost like buying a $200 Raspberry Pi.
Except now you've got 8-Bit Steve who's saying, wow, I guess it could double as a cryptocurrency miner. No, don't do that. No, that's not what this is for.
I don't know what protocols you'll have the best luck with, right? But yeah, if you just want to do like MD5 and SHA's, it can go pretty fast.
Yeah, this thing would be pretty incredible at hashing things, I would think.
I ran this exact same test against a quad-core i5 and, dual-core 4 threads, and this little box outperformed my Intel i5 CPU for that kind of crunching.
All right. I got to bring in my co-host here because I know they're a little mouth agape here. Curtis, I know you've got one incoming right now. This is a weird thing. This is why we have this on This Week in Enterprise Tech. This technology started with the enterprise. That's where it comes from. This sort of high-end silicon that was dedicated to pushing a lot of packets. The fact that it's now available at a ridiculously low price, that it could be in homes, this is the kind of thing that we hope for when we were talking about locking down the internet, right? You make those weakest points now almost as protected as some of the most secure points.
Exactly so. And that's something that we've talked about in the past, that when you have people working remotely, working from home offices, working from all sorts of places, all of a sudden when they VPN back into your enterprise network, they really become the border for your network. And so protecting your border at those locations is as important as the big firewall you've got on your core stack back in your data center.
All right.
Something like this is tremendously important for keeping your core network safe, because you can reduce the possibility of lateral infestation from someone who, whether through carelessness or just very persistent malicious attack, allows their corporate issued machine to become infected, or their private machine that they then use to communicate back to the corporate network. Protecting them is important because it protects your core network. And as you say, this level of protection is incredibly important and very new.
And there's nothing like this. There's nothing like this outside of buying a $10,000 box for your home. Chiebert, I could see something like this being a product that if you ran an enterprise, you'd say, look, if you want to connect to the enterprise, to the network at home, you use this box. We're not installing anything on your computer, because this box will not only allow you to create that secure tunnel, but it will also alert us if too much data is running in either direction. In other words, if you've now become a point of vulnerability. That's next-gen networking, yes?
Oh, yeah. And this is something that I'd tell anyone. You know, if you're a manager and say, hey, you're going to allow someone to work remotely, I would even say, put it into the hotel rooms, you know, travel with it, put it in all the homes. This is not going to be optional in the future. You know, you've got to have some sort of protection. You've got to reduce the attack surface. Dan Gear harped on this for like 5 minutes during his keynote. Reducing the attack surface means we have to protect all the way to the edge. And the edge of the enterprise network isn't from the home office or regional office, it's the work at home worker.
Yeah, I think Dan's quote was, if he wanted to own the internet, he wouldn't go after enterprise networks, he would go after the edge, because the edge is the most vulnerable and the edge can overwhelm the core. And now if we could get boxes like this out on the edge, well, we've just eliminated a huge weak space area. Gentlemen, I'm sorry we have run out of time. That's right, folks. You've spent another hour with the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 VPNs. I want to thank all of our panelists, especially to you, Daniel, for coming all the way up here, for continuing to show us this box. I know it's been a long journey. You've had a lot of perseverance to get to this point. So I want to thank you, because This is the culmination of a lot of the things that we've talked about on this show. Could you please tell the folks at home, this is your time, talk about anything you want, where they find you, where they find ITUS Networks, where they could pre-order one of these things, where they can stay abreast of developments.
Sure. So you can follow us on Facebook or on Twitter. It's at ITUS Networks, and or you can see it there under my name. Or you can find us right on our website. And I'm very responsive. If you want to just shoot me an email through the web form, I'm happy to answer any questions folks have. I'm sure if you talk to our Kickstarter backers, they've found that we've been very responsive in getting them back information. But yeah, like I said, we're planning on starting shipping next month. Right now, we're taking pre-orders at a special discounted price. Once we start shipping next month, the price will go up by about $30 or so per unit. So
if you want one of these, you might as well get it now. I mean, you've seen it in action, you've seen what it does. And the fact that it's running Linux means you can play a lot with this box. This is not just your grandmother's firewall. Again, Daniel, thank you so very much. We will have you back on. We will show off this gear. I'm making it a personal point of pride to make sure the world knows about The Guardian. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Potter. Thank you so much for having me. Great to be here.
Of course, I need to thank my two co-hosts. We wouldn't have a show without them, really. They are the brain, the heart, the beauty, pretty much everything that makes Twiat, Twiat. Starting with you, Chiebert, what should the Twiat Riot do if they want to keep up with you? I know you've got a lot of projects going on right now, a lot of irons in the fire. I know that you're getting about 2 hours of sleep, so can you tell us what you're doing with the other 22 hours?
Well, right now I'm getting ready to stand up a VDI server for Kapi'olani Community College. In fact, I'm going to be delivering the physical servers today and start standing it up. I'm also doing a lot of work with the Hawaii Natural Energy Institute doing power monitoring systems. We are actually in the process of rolling out a smart grid at the University of Hawaii Manoa campus.
Fantastic. And Curtis, what do you have going on other than, of course, Enterprise Connect?
Well, I'm going to be at Enterprise Connect next week, and then I get to come home for a couple of days, just long enough to be on TWiET next week. Then I'm off to San Francisco for InteropNet's Hot Stage for 2 weeks. Going to be doing a lot of radio, a lot of writing, a lot of generally getting ready for Interop at Hot Stage. So a lot of good stuff going on. Hope everyone will keep up with me down here at KG4GWA. Even check out, I've started an Instagram account, lots of photographs of where I'm going, what I'm doing. Follow me there. Keep up with all the excitement.
Gentlemen, thank you so very much. And I look forward to talking to you next week. Now, folks, we also want to thank you. That's right, the loyal listener, the viewer, the person who downloads our show each week. We wouldn't have a show if it wasn't for you. So we want to give you a way to get TWiET automatically into your devices of choice. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/TWiET. Once you're there, you'll find not only all of our episodes, our entire back catalog, but also a drop-down menu so you can subscribe to the RSS feed that will give every episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech into your iPhone, your iPod, your Zoom, your laptop, your desktop. No matter what it might be, we've got a format for you. If you want to listen to the audio on your phone on your way to work, you could do that. If you want to watch a video version on your tablet during your breaks, you could do that. If you want to watch the high-definition version because you just heard about all the ITUS goodness and you want to actually see what he was doing, you can do that. Also, don't forget that you can follow me on Twitter. Just go to twitter.com/PadreSJ. That's at PadreSJ. There you will find what I'm going to be doing on all of my shows on the TWiT TV network. If you want to suggest topics or guests for future shows, if you want to see what I do with cats and dogs and quadcopters, you can do that. If you want to see what happens in between the different shows I do for TWiT TV, twitter.com/PadreSJ is the place to go. Also, don't forget that we do this show live every Friday, usually about 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific time. Fridays are weird days. Just go to live.twit.tv and you can see the pre-show, the post-show, and everything that goes in between, including all the bloopers that get taken out of the final reel. And as long as you're watching live, please join us in the chat room. You see me calling out to the people in the chat room all the time. You guys live right up there, right above my screen, so I can find out what questions you have, whether or not you're understanding what's going on in the show, and so you can be part of the experiment that is TWiT TV. Finally, I want to thank everyone here in the Brick House who makes this show possible. Of course, to Lisa and to Leo for letting me do this show, to my super producer, Karsten Bondi, and to my TD. That's right. We call him Eskimo Jack. I don't think he has a camera on himself right now because we stole all the cameras, but he's got a microphone. Eskimo Jack, Eskimo Zach, could you please tell the folks at home where they could find you?
Yes, you can follow me at Twitter. That's Eskimozach. And thank you, Padre.
And he just passed 100 Twitter followers. If he passes 200 Twitter followers, who knows what he'll do. I'm not going to make any promises. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer. This has been This Week in Enterprise Tech. And remember, if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep TWiET.